Hello and welcome back to AP World History Modern. Today we're going to be looking at Unit 9.6, Globalized Culture After 1900. And really, CCOT is our skill today. So we're looking for how and why globalization changed over time. And we'll do some skill practice along the way. All right, so here's our standards. Okay. All right, so global culture, right? Global culture is our topic today. All right, get this up and running. All right. So let's just kind of run through and do some kind of basics with this. All right. So where's the largest film producer in the world? Right. The answer, right? Bollywood. Bollywood, and this is part of your homework last night, so I know you are familiar with that. So, now if you're going to look at Bollywood, right, if you're going to kind of look at Bollywood, I forgot to kind of do this. So, sorry, I forgot to start with this. Oh, my bad. So, this was our activity yesterday in class. I need to go over answers. So, I apologize. I got a little ahead of myself there. So, this was our claim writing activity, right? So, for the most part, the answers I received in class are pretty solid, and all of the answers I received via email have been great. So, very well done on this. So, as far as categories of analysis, right? Here's some kind of solid ways in which you could try to kind of organize this prompt, right? Looking at how politics affected gender roles in women. For women in 20th century Latin America. Here's some kind of good ways that you could organize these into categories of analysis. So if you're using document one as a kind of starter, and then we can support these claims with evidence from the document. Here's for document two. As far as like which documents are most commonly used, or I could kind of see the direct connection. Document two is probably the most commonly used by students to create their categories of analysis, like this idea of women taking leadership roles, right? Women's taking leadership roles, at the local level, right? To encourage change. And then document three is probably the second more commonly used one. The involvement in socialist movements as a way of attaining greater equality. All right. So here's just kind of a generic claim that you could have used, or you could have come up with using these documents. So politics often affected gender roles in Latin America to a great extent. The revolution to protect lower classes through a new political system often led to greater participation into politics for women. All right. So one way you could approach that. All right. So, but like I said, if you're in class, we went over this and some different examples, and from what I saw from the one submitted by email, that did an excellent job. All right, so this is where we left off. So in class, just talking about Bollywood, like why does Bollywood matter, right? Why do we learn about Bollywood? Why is Bollywood significant? As we've been talking about for the past few topics, the power of culture within a society for ideological purposes is a major factor in determining the kind of acceptance of an ideology within a society. And so we've already talked about this, I guess, within the when we were kind of looking at the Frankfurt School and the use of culture by Marxists in the 20th century. I don't think there's a connection between Antonio Gramsci, another 20th century socialist, and the Frankfurt School. don't think there is, but it is from Antonio Gramsci, that we, you know, a 20th century Marxist, that we, you know, that we get the idea of hegemony from, right? So when you're talking about the power of, you know, of film, you know, film industries, it's an amazingly powerful thing, right? And this is something in which Marxist organizations especially have kind of taken full advantage of over the past, you know, past two generations. And so we see this, you know, kind of see this manifest itself in a lot of ways in which, you know, maybe you'll look at in a different class. But this is why we see such a kind of investment in these kinds of industries, you know, around the world. You know, if you look at your Netflix accounts today, and, you know, who is the kind of largest producer of your content on those kinds of platforms? And I don't have Netflix, so I really don't know, but I had a 30-day trial once, and I was really surprised with the amount of Chinese content on that platform. You know, not just adult content, but also children's content. You know, so you are seeing multiple countries, especially as they are looking to spread their ideology, right, and establish their kind of hegemonic presence around the world. You're seeing increased use of this kind of thing. So let's look at a document, and in class, you know, we'll read through this document. This is something I picked up. I think I was listening to NPR, National Public Radio, and they were talking about Bollywood. And so I listened to a thing on that, so I went and sought it out. I think I pulled this off from the NPR website. So in class, you know, we read this, so please go ahead and pause it for a second and read it. So in class, we read this, and generally we kind of, you know, pull this apart a little bit. So, you know, in class, I'll ask, which of our, you know, writing skills are you seeing demonstrated here? And just as a reminder, our writing skills are comparison, causation, and CCOQ, right? So which of our skills are we seeing here? All right, so the obvious answer, I guess you could make an argument for comparison. I'm sorry, for CCOT, for change. But I think you're also, the strongest case is going to be made for causation, right? You're seeing the effects, right? The effects of Bollywood or the film industry itself, right? On, you know, the effect of culture, right? On behavior. And, right, so this is, so once we've identified that, you know, I usually ask students to identify a specific claim that is being made in this passage about the effects of Bollywood. Right, so, you know, in generally speaking, you know, there's two things that are going to get pulled out. One is the names, right, the name claim that is being made there, and then students would generally kind of pull out this, you know, this fertility impact of, you know, of popular culture. And, you know, when you're looking at those two claims, you know, I'll ask students to, you know, so I'm just kind of saying this kind of, you should be thinking about this because this is the kind of things that we think about in class. You know, which of these claims seems stronger to you, you know, just as it is currently stated, and which one seems a little weaker to you, right? So, and so the name one generally pops up as the kind of stronger assertion, right? Kind of easy to prove, right? Easier one that you could prove with additional evidence, whereas this one comes up as a little bit more challenging, right? So I usually kind of take this as a really good time to explore this concept of a nuanced understanding of a topic. Or how can you demonstrate a more nuanced, right, kind of in-depth understanding of what you're talking about. So we'll kind of discuss this and why there might be some issues with this particular claim. You know, students will generally, right, so I guess you should kind of think about this, you know, as you're watching this. If you need to stop and write a few things down, that would be encouraged. You know, but what students will generally kind of come up with is, there's this reduction in fertility amongst women, you know, is probably not, you know, not caused only by this. This is probably a correlation versus a causation kind of issue. That there's probably a number of different factors, in the global south that are contributing to this, such as urbanization, such as increased access to education. So yeah, yesterday we talked about the literacy rate in India, for example, going up to, I think it was like 54% back in 2001. So increase in literacy and access to education. Increased urbanization also results in increased access to healthcare, and you can make that birth control pill connection here as well. So, you know, given the fact that, you know, there's probably multiple things going on here, how could we connect this back to this? You know, so how can I demonstrate a complex connection here? You know, after I identify all those things, I could probably make a connection saying that, you know, women who have greater access to employment, or higher levels of education generally result in greater access to employment and increased amount of disposable income, can afford to have televisions, right? And so people who watch these types of programs probably have access to electricity and television, are probably also the same people that have higher levels of education and access to employment, and greater access to healthcare. So there's probably a connection between the two, that's, you know, trying to cite that those novellas are the direct cause of that, right? It's something that is probably minimizing, right, what's actually going on. All right, so that's, you know, kind of one of the big skill things that we do. We spend a decent amount of time in, you know, in class kind of flushing that whole thing out. All right, so let's get back to our topics here. So in class, we just kind of say, who is the only non-American UK artist in the Rolling Stone top 20 artists of all time? And I always feel compelled to explain to students that Rolling Stone is a magazine. So that's what we're talking about here. Right. So what do you think the answer to that is? Right. And most students can generally, let me turn it down a little bit too much. Right. You know, this is generally a pretty easy one to... to get, right? So, you know, when we try to talk about why are we looking at this specific topic, it's because, you know, reggae is a really good example of cultural syncretism, right? For one thing, it's a really good example of that. And it's also kind of noted for, you know, a form of social criticism as well, and right, and a form of resistance. So if you kind of look through the catalog of reggae music, there's a lot of songs that are kind of focused on love and socialization and personal things, but there's also a fair amount, you know, that deal with social issues. Of course, Buffalo Soldier is a famous example of that. Okay. All right. So So reggae music, mix of Jamaican folk, jazz, R&B, and much, much more, as you just saw that last thing. All right. So reggae spreads worldwide and becomes a global movement. And we see really, especially in the 1990s, we see kind of reggae, you know, itself becoming part of, you know, kind of undergoing that syncretism process and combining with other genres of music. So, all right. Next, which social media site has the most users? All right, so this is as of 2020. All right, so answer, Facebook, right? Facebook is the answer to that. All right, so 2.4 billion active users. Wrap your mind around that number. Almost 2.5 billion with a B, active users, right? Not just accounts, active users. All right, social media. You know, what is the 32nd most popular website? Twitter is, right? So, and of course, since, you know, this is an AP class, you know, you should know that Twitter is where the College Board posts information. Proposes its information about testing and resources that are available to you. Where's the largest broadcaster in the world? Yeah, this is kind of interesting. You know, when we talk about this in class, the answer always comes out. Right, the answer kind of always comes out. But you know, but it is kind of interesting to hear what students guess it is, right? But yeah, you know, the answer is BBC. Right? The BBC is the largest broadcaster in the world. You know, and kind of like your American major broadcast companies like ABC, NBC, CBS, BBC has its origins in radio, and then eventually kind of makes that transition into television as the technology develops. CNN is a latecomer to the game. They've never really had a radio presence, right? So, but BBC is, you know, I guess the closest thing to the BBC in the United States might be like an NPR, a national public radio, in that they're both similar because they are both funded by the government, right? Kind of government funded in private donations. However, the BBC also has a much more prominent role in British society than what NPR does in the United States. It has a massive television footprint, much, much larger than a PBS. The television version of, you know, of the government funded site. So it's kind of like a PBS or an NPR, but it has the reach of an NBC or an ABC or CBS. All right. Who has won the most World Cup soccer titles, right? The World Cup titles. So this is kind of hit a couple of the big ones, right? Or the countries that have won a few. Recently added one. Another recent addition of the previous, the one before the last. And the answer is Brazil, right? So in class, we'll watch a little clip here from the France-Croatia game back from 2018. And it's really just kind of a highlight of the major goals that happened. France drawing first blood. And sadly, it looks like an own goal, right? And this is actually a pretty high scoring endeavor. So I think this is the last goal here. It's kind of a cool thing because it was actually scored by a teenager. First time since Pele that a teenager scored in the World Cup final. Yes. So we watched that in class, right? So then we kind of transition over here to who's won the most women's World Cup titles. So we can kind of run through the ones. Japan over there, the twos, or two, right? So the Women's World Cup is a much newer, right? Kind of a much newer competition. So in class, we watched this as well. This is from the 2019 USA-Netherlands match. So FIFA World Cup France. I remember watching this game because I was in Europe when this game was being played. It's a pretty nasty foul here. So it's PK. It's the Pino against Van Zegendal. It's one now. Oops. And then the second one. Yeah.
United States 2, the Netherlands 0.
All right, so in class, we'll watch this, and then we'll just kind of talk about this just for a second, let's try to make some connections to what we've been talking about. So, can you make a connection between stuff going on in the world today regarding soccer, and a topic we've been talking about in the last class session the last class session or two. In what invariable comes up is, students will try to make a connection between, the women's movement, right? So, and what's going on today, because most students have seen Rapinoe before, are familiar with Rapinoe and what she is currently advocating, right? So, and it's just, we'll kind of play this out in class as a quick discussion. So just since you're not here today, just some of the highlights are some of the things that usually come up is what, Rapinoe is in the news for and what she's been advocating for. So if you're not familiar with this, as many of you are not, she's pointed out some economic disparities that exist between the U.S. men's national soccer team and the women's national soccer team. And she has been a pretty vocal proponent of having the U.S. women's soccer team receive equal pay to what the U.S. men's soccer team. And some of the arguments that are often used to support this assertion that she's making is, they look at success that the U.S. women's soccer team has had. So 4 World Cups, compared to the men's 0 World Cup wins. She also kind of points out the reality that both are playing at the top of their game. These are both the kind of elite level, the highest level you can go, and we typically kind of see arguments, arguments that like that are used to explain that. So what, kind of looking for a word to describe what she's talking about, is she is asking for what would be known as equity, right? So, and equity is a word that is kind of increasingly being used. So equity is the belief that there should be equality of outcome, right? Equality of outcome. And we've been kind of talking about what words mean and how, where were the origins of words for the past few days, right? So but what she's asking for is equity. So what does this tell? What does this mean, right? What are the implications of this? So she is advocating, and I don't know if she's advocating sponsorship, not private kind of money coming into plays, but what is being advocated is that the National Soccer Federation here in the United States, should take some of the money that is being used to pay the men, and that money should be balanced out to equally pay both men and women. And of course, this will always kind of bring up, well, what is the limiting principle associated with this concept? So, is this something that Rapinoe is simply advocating for soccer and soccer only and those who support this idea? Or if there is no limiting principle associated with this belief that there should be equity in pay, right? So, assuming hypothetically there's not, where does it go from here, right? So I guess the next logical place to go would be maybe the NBA and the WNBA, so the major stars in the NBA, who make, I have no idea how much they make, to be honest with you, $20-30 million a year, maybe. If you don't take into account the money that they get from private sponsors, are they really tens of millions of dollars a year better than the elite WNBA players? Does that merit, that kind of pay gap? And if you're following this equity argument, then the answer would be no, right? So maybe, your high profile NBA players need to obviously not be paid as much, right? Because that has to come from somewhere. You can't just up the money. Like, the money has to come from somewhere. So this is this is kind of one of those issues, has kind of societal cultural implications, right? So kind of bring this back to Antonio Gramsci, in his idea of hegemony, right? So if you want to make an argument, then bring it into the cultural sphere. The cultural sphere is a great place to, this is where ideology is won, right? The counter argument to this, right, is this notion of equality, right? So equality does not mean the same thing as equity, right? Then kind of in no way are these the same things. They may sound similar, but they are not similar at all ideologically, right? When you kind of look at the origins and how these words are used, right? So the counter argument is that equality of opportunity is what is presented here, right? So anyway, this is we don't really get too deep into that, just because getting too deep into cultural issues in class is very quickly gets us off our skill application. So, but that's usually kind of as far as we kind of take it, just kind of trying to make some connections, without going too far. All right, sports is who has the most combined Olympic gold medals? Right, so French, English, Germans, Russians / Soviet Union, right, and United States. Right, United States. Within consumerism, since this is also part of our content here, what is the world's largest retailer? World's largest retailer, Alibaba, right? The Alibaba Group. So, yes, this has been, it's been in the news a lot over the last few years. A few years ago when they went public, right? So when they went public. Technically they are the sixth largest, Amazon being number one, right? But retailer, right? They are in the news quite a bit for one when they went public a few years back. But also their founder and CEO, has been in the news quite a bit lately. Jack Ma is his name. All right. Consumerism, right? Who is the number two e-commerce company? eBay, right? So eBay's, Alibaba is kind of an eBay Amazon combination, right? So Alibaba, sixth most valuable global brand, Amazon number one, right? But Alibaba is a massive Chinese e-commerce retailer. Okay. All right. So global brands, who's the second largest auto manufacturer in the world and the largest company in Japan? Right, so Volkswagen is number one here, right? So Toyota, that's pretty easy considering how large their footprint is in the United States. What's the most valuable global beverage company? This is a question that I don't think any student's ever not guessed. So pretty easy. All right, so let me just kind of go through a couple of other things real quick. Sometimes if time permits, we'll watch a little video. There is this, I'm not going to post this just because the language is questionable, but I have in the past shown like little clips about this just to kind of show some of the other ways of looking at, FIFA, right, in the World Cup and some of the kind of modern kind of social issues that are connected to it. Sometimes we watch this kind of stuff in class. All right, let me kind of scoot through. All right, so kind of just make sure we're connecting these things kind of back to globalization, okay, and the interconnectedness. Kind of make sure we understand where does it all come from. How do all these things play and interrelated with each other, right? And this is also from your reading last night. What is the reaction and the resistance to this kind of stuff? So religious fundamentalism, plays up in different regions or becomes issues in different regions, right? So You know, so we are seeing a lot of nationalism and populism, rising up in reaction to globalization, or we have seen that. We've seen it in India, we've seen it in the United States, right? And undoubtedly throughout the Islamic world, Dar al-Islam, right? We also kind of see it in, you know, backlash to the United Nations and in England with Brexit, right? So there's Boris. All right. We did not get to do this today in class, so I'm just gonna kind of skip by all this, and maybe we'll come and do this a different day. We'll do that activity. Okay. All right, so some debrief summary. Globalization struck the world in the 20th century, affected societal, economic, and governmental structures, and struggle of symbolic global victories in the 20th and early 21st century has resulted in dramatic moments in the Olympics, World Cup soccer. You know, this is, you know, this whole symbolic victories, we've used that kind of verbiage before during the Cold War with the Olympics, right? So, you know, so World Cup soccer is, you know, is, you know, kind of also a player in this. One of the things that we did not talk about today, and I do just want to show you this really quick, is cricket. And so if you kind of scroll up from where you're watching this, I have embedded a Netflix that was online, a little video about cricket. And ooh, I'm on the wrong page. Let me 9.6. I did kind of embed a little video about cricket, and the beginning part is really, really good. So you a different way of how sports and globalized culture, how they get that way. And, you know, and I hate when I do this. Let me go back. I know what my problem is. So I'm going to open up like this. I should have had that queued up, I guess. I apologize. I'm just gonna open it up and then change my user profile. My work one. All right. So let's just watch the first minute or two of this. Or technically, I guess you can just not watch this at all. And you can just sign off if you want. All right? Because it's on the website as well.
Deeply rooted in a tradition and in the ritual of tradition brings.
Yeah, got less cricket, it has a deeper in the game. It's definitely a test of attention. A lot of people can't get their mind around how you stand up there by the game.
The cricket has changed. This is a form of sport. It's bringing in more money, fans, and different style of play. But one thing hasn't changed.
It's complicated. It is one of the most complicated sports on earth. It's been really follow any obvious reason.
That didn't put off the 1 billion people that were estimated to have watched a single cricket match in 2015 between India and Pakistan. That's 1 in 7 days. So how did this confusing British game become one of the most popular sports on earth?
I'm guessing when it's all people.
I'm going to skip by this kind of instructions because they do talk about the spread of it. That's kind of what I want to. That's kind of what I want to watch.
The British didn't just write the rules of cricket; and spread it around the world by taking it to their colonies in the 18th and 19th centuries.
Right, so this is a kind of an interesting little case study of a sport, of how does a sport start and then become a, you know, how does it spread around the world, right, and become a global, you know, a global sport. And we see this with a lot of sports today. So, I mean, you know, obviously we see a connection between baseball in the United States and Japan, going back to the kind of early years, the first couple of decades of the Meiji era. So by the turn of the 20th century, we see baseball being played in Japan. Today, the NBA, you know, the National Basketball Association, is making a very real effort to try to bring and establish basketball in China. You know, so you do see kind of some, you know, some attempts to kind of do this. This is one that spread through colonialism, right? Kind of it is part of so many countries around the world because of the British Empire. I remember when I was living in Australia, I went to a day-night match versus the West Indies, skippered by Richie Richardson, I believe his name was. God, that was a long time ago. So it was West Indies versus, you know, the Windies, West Indies versus Pakistan is who I went and saw a day-night match on.
But in other colonies, playing cricket was an opportunity to beat the colonists of their own game. And the English began inviting teams to come test their skills against them in England. The competitions were called test matches.
All right, so, and if you're kind of interested in this, this kind of shows how it spread and then how it kind of became popularized within individual colonies. And of course, you have test matches, you've got, you know, later on they develop, and this will explain all this. You know, it will give rise to the day-night matches, you know, and then, of course, today we have a whole different format, which I've never even, you know, this happened after I moved back to the U.S., or at least became popular. Right? I guess it goes back to the early 80s is when it originated, the 2020s. And from what I understand, it's very popular in India, you know, today. It's kind of a much more bridged, you know, kind of a couple hours type of game. So cricket's kind of, you know, has condensed from what it used to be. You know, and become a, you know, and of course, so when you talk about symbolic global victories, you know, playing within the Commonwealth countries, you know, you'll see, in addition to soccer and Olympics, you're going to see, you know, sports that spread by colonialism, such as rugby and cricket. All right. So that is all for today. Stop priority.